Welcome back to Recap Day. Today we shall talk about the story of Benny, a cute but dumb-looking black boy. During his schooling time, all his classmates get very good marks on their class tests, but his marks are highly predictable. He scores in single digits every freaking time, and becomes a laughingstock. For his classmates, he thinks he is the dumbest person, and tells his mother that he cannot improve, as he is dumb. But his mother has another notion. She constantly motivates him, saying, he too can achieve great things in life. This is a true story of a man in flesh and blood, an extraordinary life of an ordinary person, who achieves the impossible, despite being mocked at, and racially harassed time, and time again, by friends, and teachers. He bounces back, and does what only a genius can do. His story begins in his classroom. He is predictable again, gets a zero on his class test. A girl says that he has got none, but the class teacher hears it. While other students score above 20, the teacher appears to be happy with Bernie's poor score. When she thinks that is 9, this is quite an improvement by Bernie's standards. When everybody finds Bernie's marks, the class laughs loudly, as if routinely. This does not stop here. To make things worse, people mock Bernie whenever they find him. Bernie is followed everywhere, not because he is celebrated, but for the wrong reason. A group of bullies follow him, and start bullying him. He looks frustrated, as anyone would in his situation. Bernie gets furious, and cannot control his rage, and punches a boy's face with a lock in his hand. Bleeding him out, the principal calls his mom into his office, and warns her of the incident. He also shows her Bernie's report card, which is no less worrisome for the young mother. In almost every subject, he fails. These bullying incidents greatly influenced Bernie's confidence and thought process. He repeatedly tells his mom Sonia that he is not smart enough, but his mother is a fountain of motivation for him, and his elder brother Curtis. One day Bernie asks his mother for help in his studies. Sonia dodges the situation by saying that she needs a new reading glass. She finds out that Bernie has a problem with his eyes. He cannot read because he cannot see the small words properly. He gets his glasses, and voila! He starts improving his grades, class tests, and spelling competition. He goes to the church for a Sunday morning sermon. The minister appears to be a great speaker and motivator. He tells a story of a doctor. In his speech, Bernie starts to imagine himself as the doctor, and resists a pirate. This imagination gives him the key to a wholly different world of learning and growing. He comes back home, and tells his mother that he wants to be a doctor. He goes past his disbelief that he is not smart. A new vista of life opens up for him, but Sonia is not happy. The boys spend a lot of time watching TV. She feels sad, and visits a psychiatric facility. She tells the doctor about her fear and anxiety. She could not go to school, and got married at the tender age of 13. She finds out that her husband has another wife and child. She continues the marriage because she was concerned about her boy's upbringing. But she further gets to know about her husband's engagement and drug dealing. She comes out of the marriage and brings up her boys as single mother. Her life is hard. She works as a cleaner to run the family, but her truth is hidden from her children. This causes great havoc on her mental health, and the fear and anxiety starting to eat her up, giving her depression. The doctor finds out that she has suicidal thoughts. He suggests that she get admitted for a few days. She is worried, but she decides the same. Sonia tells Curtis and Bernie that she is visiting Detroit. She leaves them in an elderly woman's care. She asks the boys to memorize the tables. The boys protest, but they have no way out. When Sonia reaches the hospital, she finds a letter by Bernie among her belongings, full of spelling mistakes, but the letter is very moving. Sonia gets emotional seeing the letter. Meanwhile, Bernie keeps improving his studies. Now, he gets 24 out of 25 on a class test. He runs home to tell her sister, Scott, their caregiver, but to his surprise, he finds his mom is back home. He embraces her, says about his progress, and shows her his marks. Sonia is visibly very proud and happy. She keeps motivating Bernie and keeps improving. Sonia meanwhile finds cleaning work at a learned and compassionate person's house. She is gobsmacked by seeing a huge room full of numerous books. She comes back home and sees her boys are watching TV. She switched it off and agrees that the boys should go to the library, read 2 books every week, and write a report on each of them. She also declares that the boys can only watch 2 TV programs every week after finishing their homework. The boys look frustrated, but they listen to their mom. They enroll themselves in a library and develops their reading habit. They start the process of learning on TV as well. They watch a quiz show to broaden their minds. This new love for learning starts giving Bernie a dividend. Instantaneously, the class teacher picks a rock and asks the class if they know about it. Nobody knows, except a doubtful Bernie. He says that the rock is obsidian. He goes on to explain the process of obsidian formation. The teacher is surprised by the depth of knowledge of this young lot. He asks Bernie to talk to him. After the class, Bernie meets him, and the teacher says that he has unlocked the power of his brain. This is quite a statement, especially when it comes from your teacher. Throughout, Bernie does very well in his class. He excels in spelling, he wins the spelling competition in his class, but the class teacher looks unhappy, but she has no way, but declares that Bernie is the winner. She comes out to be a racist at the annual award function. The school's principal announces that Bernie is the best student in his overall performance. His mother and brother are in the audience. They look no less proud than Bernie. Bernie collects his certificate, but the racist teacher comes to the mic and says something that shows her deep down racist mentality. She says that the other students should be ashamed, because though Bernie is a black student and raised by a poor single mother, they could not achieve more than Bernie. She unfortunately could not see Bernie's talent beyond her racist views of life. The incident rattles Bernie's mom. She decides to get Bernie admitted, where his talent can be appreciated irrespective of his skin color. She gets him admitted to a school where most of the students are black. If not all, Bernie is bullied there by a student for his shabby old clothes, which do not fit the fashion of his generation. Bernie replies to him in his language, and they become friends. This friend is a fashionista in his fancy clothes and a good hat. This gives Bernie an inferiority complex and a sense of insecurity. He asks for money from his mom for new clothes. His mom does not have much, but she reluctantly gets money and buys Bernie a new pant. Bernie does not like the shabby looking pant. He argues with his mom. He wants clothes like his fashionista friend, but his mom dislikes that and says that persons with high fashion are voided inside. Bernie gets furious. During an argument, he takes up a hammer that his mom was using to fix the window and goes to charge at her. His brother comes to the rescue. He gets in the bad company of friends. His fashionista friend takes him to a gang, where he buys a knife. During an argument, his friend insults him. Bernie takes the knife and stabs him. For both of their luck, no serious thing happens, as the knife was already broken. Bernie runs in fear from the school. This is a blessing in disguise, as he leaves the toxic and harmful friendship. Besides, he realizes the bad effects of anger, and he learns to control his ill temper. He gets admitted to the famous college Yale on a scholarship. There, he meets his girlfriend Candy. He is worried about his studies and future. He does not like the lectures and does not feel like attending the classes. He finds it very hard to adjust to Yale life, and he tells Candy that he is only good at reading. Candy helps him out, and she says that he can study all by himself. Bothers him there most. He studies so hard that he begins hallucinating. He likes the chemistry professor. He is writing down the formula for him on the board. His hard work pays off in the exam. He does very well and decides to become a neurosurgeon. He applies to Johns Hopkins, which is the most renowned institution in the United States. Johns Hopkins was taking only 2 resident students for neurosurgeon facility. This is cutthroat competition indeed. Only the best of students can get an opportunity. There, Bernie is steadfast that he wants to get admitted only there, and nowhere else, and applies nowhere else. He takes an interview. His confidence impresses the doctor. When asked why he wants to be a neurological surgeon, Bernie replies that the brain is a mysterious organ, and wants to unfold its mystery. He says that he believes that a miracle can happen, and he wants to do the miracle. His confidence impresses the interviewer, and he gets his admission, and continues to excel at Johns Hopkins. He is not liked by people, a senior doctor tells him that, he is not exceptional. He sounds racial, and tells Bernie, now, Dr. Carson to do what he has asked to do. He becomes a resident doctor. An emergency case comes, and the patient needs surgery immediately. This is a life and death situation. There is no doctor available to attend to the patient, but the resident Dr. Carson. He does not have a license, and is not eligible to operate on a patient who is fighting death. But he operates, and saves the patient, risking his whole career which he had dreamed of all his life. He is called by his senior in his office, and he is worried that he can be rebuked for his actions. But to his surprise, the senior doctor appreciates what he has done to save a life. The business in his hospital duty goes on. Like this, a young couple comes to the hospital with their daughter who has seizures all the time. She is awake, and the other doctors said that she is half. Dr. Carson says that she needs a hemispherectomy which would remove an area of the brain which is seizure prone. This is very risky as it could paralyze the child, or she could lose her speaking and motor ability. He assures the parent that the child's brain has a remarkable ability to recover. The brain cells take up the functions of the diseased cells and restore neurological function, but this is a gamble. Moreover, he did not do an operation like this before, but he takes up the challenge to kill a child. The night before the operation, he looks anxious. He kneels and prays. Finally, he starts operating on the child. In the morning, he operates the child very carefully. The operation is done now. It is the moment of judgment. The anesthesiologist tries to bring the child back to conscience, and everybody is very worried. The situation gets tensed up, and every second, she does not respond. She is moved to the general ward, and Dr. Carson briefs the parents, and says, it would take a while to know if she could speak or move, but like a miracle, the child calls out to her mom and dad. Dr. Carson wins the first of many challenges, and this incident gets media attention. In the press conference along with her parents, beside him, he tells the whole world about the success and the health of his patient. He says that the brain is a miraculous organ that made it possible, and this hemispherectomy would go on to become the go-to method in most future cases. He starts enjoying success in his professional life, but his personal life is not as sweet. His wife is pregnant, then the tragic incident happens. They lose the child stillborn, and he gives his wife time, and spends by her bedside. But his wife tells him to go to the hospital, and continue with his duty. Though reluctant, he goes. He breaks down thinking about his tragic loss. His mom consoles him, and says that he can save many lives, and achieve whatever he wants in life. The next morning, he joins his duty, as usual. The most challenging of his operation is yet to come. He went to Germany on the invitation as a consultant, for the possibility of separating twins, whose head is conjoined. The case is as complex as it gets. He at first is not willing to take the case, because of the complexity of the case, but he is the best child neurosurgeon in the world. He takes the risk. He researches hours after hours, day and night, and he prepares himself for the operation. Now there, D-Day comes. The children's parents come from Germany. Dr. Carson, along with 50 members of staff, prepares for the operation. They get an alternative for each machine, and they rehearse for hours, so that no mistakes can occur. This case does not have any scope, even for a single mistake. Two groups of doctors prepare for the operation, and to tend two children separately. After the operation starts at 7:15 in the morning. It involves cardiothoracic surgeons, as well to prevent the children from bleeding out. The circulation of blood to the brain is stopped by a cardiac operation first, then the process of separation of the brain starts. Dr. Carson has only an hour to complete, if he takes more than an hour. There is a chance of being brain dead, and this will be a failure in the first place, but as usual, he does it in time, and the whole process completes in a long 22 hours period. Dr. Carson meets the parents, and informs them about the success of the miraculous complex operation. This is the story of Bernie. Thank you for watching, please remember to subscribe. Ciao.